What advice do you think you can give to a young person who wants to be a filmmaker or a writer?
Well, I would say you have to be persistent, first of all, because it's a very hard thing to get into, and it's very hard to make it, because the odds are against you. So you have to be very, you have to really love it. Kids that get into it because they think they're going to make a lot of money, or they're going to become famous, or tell a lot of people what to do all the time, it's probably best to get into a different business because they'll never make it. But if you're obsessed with film and you love to tell stories and you love working in that medium, then that'll give you the strength to be persistent to make it happen.
When it comes to filmmaking, many directors have cemented themselves in film history, from the master of suspense, Alfred Hitchcock, to the king of entertainment, Steven Spielberg. But one director and filmmaker that has always stuck out to me was the man, the myth, and the legendary George Lucas. George Walton Lucas Jr. was born on May 14, 1944 in Modesto, California. George's father was an owner of a small office supply store that the Lucas family owned and lived on a walnut ranch. From a young age, George would read books such as Louis Stevenson's Treasure Island, and he would watch Flash Gordon serials every Saturday morning. But through his teen years, George would grow to love one thing: cars. George loved street racing. For his first car, his father would give him a yellow Auto Bianchi Bianchina. It was supposed to be a simple car to get him from point A to point B, but George would take it to a local garage and he would add a racing belt and a new engine. The Yellow Rocket was the nickname George would call this new hot rod, and he would compete in local street races and would often cruise around late at night with his fellow high schoolers. However, George was failing most of his classes, and George Sr. wanted him to eventually take over the stationary business, but George's only desire was to become a professional race car driver. In a way, George saw racing as a way to truly get out of Modesto, to explore the world and build a better life for himself. But one fateful day, all that would change. On June 12, 1962, George was on his way back from studying at the library when a Chevy Impala came flying in from the opposite direction and broadsided him, causing the Yellow Rocket to crash into a walnut tree. If the racing belt hadn't snapped, George would have ended up in that tree, a dead man. George spent 4 months in the hospital, and during that period of time, George's dreams of becoming a race car driver went completely out the window, and now it was time for him to figure out what he wanted to do next. Around this time, George began to take an interest in photography and film. Through a stroke of luck, George was able to attend the University of Southern California, where he would study film. In his film class, he would watch a director that would heavily become his inspiration. That director was the great Akira Kurosawa.
First one I saw was Seven Samurai, and after that I was completely hooked. I said, you know, this is really good.
From movies like Seven Samurai to Rashomon, these movies would inspire George to start creating his own films. In his first year, George was tasked with creating a 60-second film for his animation class. The purpose of this project was just to get use of using the film for the eventual animation projects. But George put together a short film called A Look at Life. Was just supposed to be a simple project, George turned into an expression and explosive form of editing and art. With this film, I was introduced to film editing, the whole concept of editing, and I think ultimately, film editing was where my real talent was.
To me, editing is what filmmaking is really all about, because it's the one time you get a chance to create something out of material and actually deal directly with an audience. All the other times you're sort of generating material or supplies. It's like making a film is like buying lumber or cutting down trees and making wood out of it. Where editing is like actually constructing a house. I mean, you actually can see it, you can see what you're doing and deal with it. Everybody says, you know, well, the script doesn't work, but we'll fix it later. And they said, well, we're shooting this, but it isn't really working, but we'll fix it in the editing. Well, the editing is where it's got to be fixed. If it doesn't work there, the movie doesn't work.
One of his most famous student films was a futuristic parable called THX 1138 4EB. This short film would win first place at the National Student Film Festival in 1965. George would be given praise for his film by many students and film critics alike, even catching the eye of the upcoming Steven Spielberg.
Such a huge vision in so very few minutes. It just spoke volumes about the future and my favorite subject, science fiction.
In 1967, George would serve in the 6 months internships with Warner Brothers. In this internship, he would meet and befriend fellow director Francis Ford Coppola. The two would hit it off immediately, and then would eventually join forces in starting their own film company, which was called American Zoetrope. Their first film released under this new studio and company was THX 1138, which was based on George's student film. George would write and direct the film with Francis starting as the producer. George wanted the film to be shot in Japan, but even with a budget of $777,077, it still wasn't enough to go to Japan. So George settled on filming it in San Francisco, and filming began on September 22, 1969. The film would star Robert Duvall, Donald Pleasence's Maggie McCombe, and Don Pedro Colley. All actors were required to have their head shaved for the role. And to get the extras in the film, the cast and crew went to drug rehabs and paid the patients $30 a day to shave their heads. The filming would complete on November of 1969, with George spending his time editing at his own home in Mill Valley. He would edit mostly during the day while having the sound mixer edit during the night. The process of making THX 1138 felt so rewarding because George had complete creative control over the project, until he didn't.
My vision was not to do a normal story. You know, I wanted to do something that was abstract.
So we were trying deliberately to be mysterious, which I think is one of the things that drove Warner Brothers mad.
When George had submitted the finished product to Warner executive, they hated the film. This was large due to the fact that the film deliberately failed to explain the world and the story, and Warner's had a lot of trouble trying to market the film to audiences. The executives at Warner Brothers would recut the film against George's wishes, and the film wouldn't be released on March 11, 1971. The film would end up becoming a massive failure. George was frustrated and angry with the executives for getting involved when originally they weren't supposed to. After this, George vowed to never work with a major Hollywood studio again.
Automobiles. I came up with the idea of doing the movie. It was in the 60s. It was, you know, the hippie culture, drugs, cruising was gone, and I really felt compelled to sort of document the whole experience of cruising and what my generation used as a way of meeting girls.
American Graffiti would become the second film George Lucas would direct and co-write, alongside writers Willard Hueck and Gloria Katz. In this film, George would go back to his younger high school years cruising the streets of Modesto. Filming would begin on June 26, 1972, and all the major cruise scenes would be shot in downtown San Rafael in California, where they would also film in Petaluma Boulevard. The film would star Ron Howard, Richard Dreyfuss, Paul LeMau, Charles Martin Smith, Cindy Williams, and Candy Clark. Harrison Ford would also appear in the film for a small role. The music for the film would have become essential to the film, as it was the first film to utilize real-life rock and roll songs rather than composed music track. During filming, lighting would become extremely difficult, as the film was set during the nighttime. To fix this, George hired visual consultant Haskell Wexler.
Big night exteriors, particularly when the film was much slower than it is now, it took a certain amount of experience, a certain amount of expertise. For this film, I was able to get recreational vehicle lights inside the car so that we could see the actors in the car. And as far as lighting the streets, mostly we just simulated street lights, or if there were indeed street lights there, we would put 1,000 watt or 2,000 watt Nook lights on the top of the place where normal street lights are to enhance the street lights and increase it. And if there were store windows and so on, we would find out what store owners would allow us to open up their stores or leave those stores at night, so we would have some light from the store.
With the help of from Wexler, shooting would become more of a breeze. George would direct American Graffiti in a documentary film style. George would do the same thing for THX 1138, wanting the film to have sort of realistic feel. In shots where actors would mess up a line or action would end up being in the final cut.
I had like an hour before we shot the scene to practice taking it around the parking lot of the drive-in.
I showed him a little bit, and somebody else showed him.
My plan, because I was supposed to do something funny on the entrance, that was what was called for in the script, I thought I would ride it in, bump up over a curb, put the thing into like third, and let the clutch out so it would jerk. And I thought that would be funny. I got ready. We stopped traffic on Van Ness in San Francisco because it was right in the middle of downtown. There's a big crane and everything. It was this huge deal. So I came in. I finally got the Vespa and came around, bumped up over the curb. It wasn't really all that good a bump. I wasn't that happy with it. And I couldn't get it into third. So I just left it in first and let the clutch out, hoping it would stall. But instead, it took off. So this thing scoots forward this way with me still hanging on to it, bangs into a trash thing that was there, and then finally stalls and dies. And if you look at the movie, I stand there for a minute thinking somebody's going to say cut, right? Because this was a mistake. This is what's supposed to happen. And I'm waiting. I don't hear George saying cut. So I figure, you know, good theater-trained actor, keep acting. So I saw Ronnie and I walked over to him. We started playing the thing. And then later on, I apologized. I said to George, I'm sorry about that. I couldn't control the thing, and I don't know how to ride a Vespa. He said, no, it was great. We're keeping it.
The film was released on August 11th, 1973, and would become a great commercial success, making over $55 million in the domestic box office. But during the tail end of the production, George would begin writing a story treatment that would change his life forever.
Thank you.
After the success of American Graffiti, George would begin writing the first draft of his space adventure movie. From the Journal of the Wills to the Adventures of Luke Starkiller, George would settle on Star Wars. George would hire artist Ralph McQuire to create concept art of the film, but when George presented his scripts to 20th Century Fox, they argued that the script was too long. George was very angry with this and decided to split the script, taking the middle portion of the story, making it into a movie, all with the intent of someday finishing his trilogy. During this time, there was not a single special effects studio that existed, so George would form Industrial Light and Magic, along with Gary Kurtz and John Dykstra. Dykstra and 75 college students would move to a warehouse in Van Nuys, and they would begin making props, costumes, and the many starships that would appear in the film. George would take huge inspirations from the writings of Joseph Campbell. This includes his book, The Hero with a Thousand Faces, which would explain the basic hero structure in every myth and religion. The hero's journey would be the structure George would use for Star Wars, with his main character, Luke Skywalker, going on a quest to save Princess Leia from the evil Darth Vader, with help from the wise mentor Obi-Wan Kenobi and swashbucklers Han Solo and Chewbacca. The cast of the film would consist of Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher, acclaimed actor Sir Alan Guinness, with Harrison Ford making a return as Han Solo, and introducing James Earl Jones as the voice of Darth Vader. Filming began on March 22, 1976, in the Tunisian desert for the scenes on the planet Tatooine, but on the first day, problems already started to occur on set. Big problems. To make matters worse, the desert had its first rainstorm in years, and the crew were starting to get under schedule.
It was the first 2 weeks of shooting. We'd run into a lot of weather problems. The sets had blown down. I didn't get everything shot. It was a disaster. At that point, I was pretty depressed, saying, boy, I've gotten myself in way over my head.
Anthony Daniels, the actor that played C-3PO, suffered a minor injury while on set.
It was bad enough as putting on the costume for the first time. And within two paces, the left leg had shattered down onto the plastic of the left foot, and was gently but forcibly and persistently knifing it into the the soft part of my foot. So we took it off, and I limped to the set with one foot. And it was then I began to panic about the days to come.
Filming would also take place in Elstree Studios in London, but challenges would still occur on set as George had to deal with strict British union regulations and everyone's lack of faith in the screenplay. Gil Taylor, the lead cameraman, would often clash heads with George on how a specific shot was supposed to be filmed. The studios also began to threaten George with shutting down productions as George was behind schedule. Filming would end in London, but George's problems wouldn't end there, as when he returned to the studios at ILM, the crew had only finished four shots.
That was a pretty much of a low point. I had no special effects, and I didn't even know whether we were going to get the ships to work. So it was a pretty desperate time, and we'd spent half the budget, you know, building the motion control cameras and setting the shop up, and it was a disaster, to say the least.
George began to feel sharp chest pains. He would then go to a hospital where he was suffering from exhaustion and stress. After this, George would step in and help with the special effects, along with Gary Kurtz. The two would push the artist of ILM to work faster and faster. For the dogfighting scenes in the film, George would splice clips of World War II movies and aerial battles so that the artist would use it as a reference to finish the scenes. Filming would end on April 22, 1977, and Star Wars was released on May 25, 1977. The film was a massive success, earning $775 million. What started as a dream that no one believed in became the biggest summer blockbuster of 1977. After the success of Star Wars, George would take a break from directing, taking the role as executive producer for both The Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. Around this time, George would collaborate with lifelong friend Steven Spielberg on a film called Raiders of the Lost Ark. George would write Raider with Steven taking the seat at the director's chair. Raiders of the Lost Ark was released on June 12, 1981, earning $389.9 million in the domestic box office, George wasn't the rough street racer kid of Modesto. He was now a global superstar. In 1967, George would meet an editor by the name of Marcia Griffin. Marcia was also born in Modesto, California, and she would become a film editor for the Motion Picture Editors Guild. Marcia would work alongside George under well-known editor Verna Fields. To quote Marcia, "He was so quiet and said very little, but he seemed to be really talented and really centered, a really together person." George would slowly begin to catch feelings for Marcia, as she was the only woman he knew that was just as passionate about film as he was. George would take her to a screening of this French short film, and soon after, the two began dating. The two would be married on February 22nd, 1969, and they would adopt their daughter, Amanda Lucas. Marcia would help George with editing both Star Wars and Raiders of the Lost Ark, but after the creation of Skywalker Ranch, the marriage began to take its toll. Due to the many commitments to both Star Wars and Lucasfilm, Marcia began to feel neglected, and around this time, she began to fall in love with another man. In mid-1982, Marcia told George she wanted a divorce. George was devastated by this, but was able to convince her to keep the divorce out of the private eye until the release of Return of the Jedi. On June 13th, 1983, George had made the divorce public.
You know, you think your life is all stable and together and the people you love are going to be there, and turn around one day and everything's different.
And Marcia would leave with $50 million in their settlement, which would hurt George, and he was still trying to keep Lucasfilm afloat. During the 90s, George had begun to experiment with digital special effects, with ILM creating the dinosaurs in the popular movie Jurassic Park. George would return to the original Star Wars trilogy, where he would add scenes and digital special effects. He would re-release the original trilogy, calling it the Special Edition. George would then start making his Star Wars prequel trilogy, this time focusing on the story of Darth Vader. George would be back in the director's chair, but after The Phantom Menace was released, it would gain hate from die-hard fans. This was largely due to George's writing and choice of using digital effects. After Revenge of the Sith was released in 2005, George would retire from the film industry due to backlash of the prequel trilogy. Later in 2012, George would sign over the rights of Star Wars to the Walt Disney Company. George would write a treatment for the Star Wars sequel trilogy, but Disney would end up not using any of George's concepts, and George's sequel trilogy, unfortunately, was never made. I think people fail to understand how much of an impact George had on the film industry, and largely this was due to people's lack of understanding of the man himself. George just wanted to tell a story. He wanted us to see the real world for what it was, and I think that is why fans now love the prequels. But it was unfortunate. Imagine putting your heart and soul into a project for people to completely shit on it because of a side character or creative choice. George was a rebel. He wasn't afraid to go against the establishment and make the movies he wanted to make. Yes, they're not perfect, but each of his films goes outside of the box, and this is what truly makes George Lucas a great filmmaker. And if you are watching this, George, I just want to say thank you for never giving up on your story and pushing the boundaries of filmmaking as a whole. And thank you for creating not just minds, but the many childhoods for adults across the world.